First, I say I want to welcome everybody to October's Hershey Civil War Roundtable. We're going to, in a minute, we'll have Scott going to be talking about the Civil War murders of York County. The first thing I'd like to do with, if everyone would please stand and follow me in the Pledge of Allegiance. If you're ready, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with justice and liberty for all. Okay, thank you.
Say the pledge, right?
And also, just I was talking with Roger Felty, and we have lost two of our members, Harvey Bomberger and Dave Popko, who's recently passed away. Like I say, Harvey passed away last year. We did not know it, but just let you know that we have lost two of our members.
Oh, Harvey.
Yeah. They've been members for a long, long time. And what you'd like to see, I want to thank Jim for this one. We were Antietam last month with Dennis Fry, and you take this picture here, and come on, Melge. Oh, I can't get the thing to work now. Oh, son of a, oh, here we go. Them crossing to us crossing the Antietam Bridge with Dennis Fry in the lead.
Whoa.
That's good, Ricky.
Yeah. Very cool.
Jim did that for us. There's one more coming up. And these are also on our website. Again, thank you very much, Jim. And, oh, there we go. The next one. This is the 130th Pennsylvania Volunteers, which the Harrisburg Roundtable have picked it up, and they're going to help maintain it. And this is a famous picture of the remainders of the volunteers. And this is us at the same spot. So I thought, Jim, you did an excellent job on that.
Yeah, bravo, Jim.
Thank you.
That was great.
Thanks. Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Also, just as a reminder, this Saturday, we're doing the Battle of Fredericksburg with Chris Mikowski. We still do have about 10 seats left. If you'd like to, we have the form to contact Norm Daniels, and what you could do is just have the check or money available on the bus, but give him a call, let him know if you're interested. Like I said, we still do have 10 seats. And it's $95. And if you've been with Chris before, he's fantastic. Also, just we'll be sending out the applications for the 2022 membership application. If you sign up now, it's still good, you know, like shows to the end of 2022. And if you also look, Robbie Corbell, who's she's on tonight or not, but you could send the check to me or to her for next month. And also, we have the sponsors. So if you could help, like say, help pay for the, we weren't able to this time, but we're trying to get a couple students to come with us and also help support our speakers and also our website. And with, that's our next speaker. And let me get out of here. Okay, Scott. What I'm going to do, folks, I'm going to mute everybody. Then I'm going to unmute you, Scott. What I ask is I'm going to mute everybody, and then at the end of the talk, go ahead and you can unmute yourself and then talk. Okay, it's all yours.
Hi, let's see if I can get my screen up. Can you see my screen right now?
Yes.
All right, good. Are the slides coming up then?
Yes.
Sounds good. Well, thanks. I appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight again. My name is Scott Mingus. I live here in York, Pennsylvania, and I bring you greetings from the York Civil War Roundtable. Tonight, in the spirit of the Halloween season, we're gonna talk about four incidents that occurred here in York County, but they happened during the Gettysburg campaign. I think they've got some utility for a lot of folks.
But with them.
So let's talk about that.
Came along, but be that as it may.
There we go. Now can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello?
I'm sorry, Scott. You're good. I muted myself, so you've got the controls.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure or not. All right. Thanks, Ricky. So you can hear me okay?
Good.
All right. Sounds good. Obviously, like many people, I grew up reading a lot of murder mysteries, especially as a teenager, and I've always been fascinated by the genre. You know, people like Sherlock Holmes and Hercule Poirot, et cetera, the Hardy Boys. So I've enjoyed that. And I moved here to York County in 2001 and started researching Civil War history. And over the years, I've realized that there are four cold cases still left here in York County that nobody to this date has solved. And I've been trying to solve them myself, as have other people over the years. So we're going to look at four different cold cases. First case we're going to look at, we don't know who the killer was. 155, 156 years later, nobody knows who the killer was. The second case we're going to look like, we know who the killer was. We don't know who got killed. Who was the victim? Case number three we're going to look at, we don't know either. We don't know the killer. We don't know the victim. We just got a body. And in case number four, we know pretty much who did the killing. We knew who the victim was, but we don't to this day really truly understand whether it was pure murder, whether it was a racial incident, or was it revenge. So let's talk about these four cases in particular. Case number one, you're not taking my horse. The unsolved mystery of Charlie Brown. Now, obviously, this time of year, we're all used to Charlie Brown and the Great Pumpkin, things like that. But this is the true story of Charles Brown, who was a soldier in the Confederate Army during the Gettysburg campaign of June and July of 1863. Charlie Brown belonged to Jube Worley's division. More specifically, he belonged to Harry Hayes' Louisiana Brigade, the 1st Louisiana Brigade, often commonly nicknamed at this point in the Civil War as Louisiana Tigers. Charles Brown was a rather obscure soldier in that unit. He had been with the Tigers since the onset of the war. And as the Confederates are operating in South Central Pennsylvania during the early part of the Gettysburg campaign, on June 26, 1863, Jube Worley's division had taken Gettysburg. They didn't want Gettysburg. That wasn't their objective. They certainly were interested in coming here to York. And eventually they went to go to Wrightsville, where the world's longest covered bridge was located, and one of only two bridges from Harrisburg, counting Harrisburg, south from the Cumberland Valley Ridge bridge down to the Maryland line. So the Louisiana Tigers, after a driving rainstorm, more than an inch, 1.3 inches of rain had fallen on Friday, June 26, prior to the rebels taking Gettysburg. On Saturday morning, June 27th, the roads are a mess, absolute god-awful mess. And they're going to try to march into York County at the same time that Richard Ewell is following roughly Route 11, heading towards Carlisle, which he's going to take that day. Jube Worley will bring his 6,600 men here towards York County. There'll be a number of smaller expeditions that will take place on the side of this, but the main Confederate columns are on Route 30, the York-Gettysburg Turnpike, or on Route 243, which is Canal Road. So let's talk about the Tigers specifically. This brigade of Louisianans had a tremendous reputation for fierceness on the battlefield. They also had a reputation for being somewhat belligerent, somewhat alcohol prone, and also they were quite the unit that enjoyed hand-to-hand fistfights among themselves almost as much as they did among the enemy. Now, they're under the command of Harry Thompson Hayes. He is, after the Civil War, will be the sheriff of New Orleans, president of the Louisiana Temperance Society. So he's a man that most people thought in Confederate high command could control these rather rowdy soldiers. He's got 196 men in the 5th Louisiana. He's got 218 in the 6th Louisiana, 235 in the 7th, 296 in the 8th, 347 men in the 9th Louisiana. And these guys have been brawling and fist fighting all the way into Pennsylvania. They continue that. And as this is going on, At one point, Hayes orders the column to stop, and Major Joseph Hanlon has two guys who are drunk who are quarreling the 6th Louisiana. He has the men of the 6th Louisiana actually fashion a boxing ring out of downed timber and stolen fence posts, and they're actually going to box it out until one of them pretty much knocks the other one senseless. Hanlon thinks this is going to at least, you know, try to get some sense of discipline in his men. But they continuously are breaking ranks, leaving the column of the Louisiana Tigers on their way, trying to find as many horses, as much loot, as much private property as they can take along the march route as they're heading towards York County. As I mentioned, this is really bad roads. William B. Hamilton, the 9th Louisiana, calls this the worst march of the Civil War. This road is ankle deep at best. And at worst, it's up to the people's knees in some of these bottom land. Again, you can see as they head on to Route 394 through Hampton, and then they turn on to Route 234, East Berlin Road, and they pass on to East Berlin. So these guys are a little drunk. They're a little grouchy. They're very tired. They're cold. They're wet. This has just been an absolutely miserable march. But one thing they clearly need as they're going through this is, again, is supplies. And a lot of these men are particularly anxious to take horses and get a horse and try to ride the horse as opposed to walk through this mud. It's not a bad thing. Now, as the earliest column approaches Big Mount on Canal Road, again, Pennsylvania Route 234, which goes north of Gettysburg through Biglerville, Aaronsville, that area, Route 234 comes to a small village, crossroads village known as Big Mount in western York County. And for those who may be somewhat familiar with this region, I've put some of the other roads to give you a flavor for where we're talking about. Big Mount is about 6 miles north of US Route 30 or so. And again, it's right on Canal Road at the intersection with Big Mount Road. Well, the Tigers are going to camp here for the night. In fact, Early's entire division, minus John Gordon's brigade and Elijah White's 35th Battalion Virginia Cavalry, who are again farther to the south, one camping on Route 30 in the case of Gordon, and the cavalry camping in Spring Forge on Route 116. There, everybody else is going to camp at Big Mount. And a lot of these soldiers break ranks fairly quickly, and they start again looting, and they start looking for horses. Now, in this region of Pennsylvania, there have been a lot of activity in the month before the Battle of Gettysburg, where a group of men, confidence men, shysters, fraudsters, if you will, from New York City, have come through South Central Pennsylvania. They have sold for $1 membership cards to the Knights of the Golden Circle, a pro-Confederate sympathy group that did not exist in York County or Cumberland or Adams County at that point in history. These are bogus counterfeit tickets to an organization that didn't exist in this region. But what these New Yorkers told the gullible Pennsylvania farmers were that, you know, if you buy these tickets, we'll teach you the secret signs, we'll teach you the secret passwords, and just show the people your tickets when the Confederates come, and they'll know you didn't vote for Lincoln, that you're a friend of the South. W.J. Seymour of the Louisiana Tigers, he's the adjutant for the Tigers Brigade, writes, "Much to our surprise, hundreds of people in the towns through which we passed greeted us with these signs, and we joyfully accepted them as proof of the anti-war feeling that pervaded the country." So the Tigers are generally finding out that when somebody is flashing one of these golden tickets, or they're saying in broken English often, because they're most of these countrymen, at least they're German in those days, they are rather surprised, pleasantly surprised, to find that the fields are filled with cattle. The horses are still in the barns or in the stables or in the fields themselves. And the Confederates are having a field day because these unsuspecting Pennsylvanians believe that these golden tickets were going to protect them from the Confederates. Obviously, the Confederates knew nothing at all about this, and they start taking whatever they want from these farmers, who again keep pleading with the Confederates that, "I bought this ticket, you know, don't bother me. Well, as the Confederates are camped in and around Big Mount, and the picture on the left of the screen is one of the campsites for Early's division. This is just east of Big Mount on Canal Road. This farm was here. General Early himself is going to sleep for the night in this building that you see on the right of the screen. That's Jubal Early's headquarters. That was the widow Zen's house. She had moved back in with her son-in-law, a guy named Trimmer, after the recent death of her husband. Well, Mrs. Zen, the widow, invites General Early in for a scrumptious meal, a multi-course meal. He says one of the finest meals he's had since he came in north of the Mason-Dixon line. And Early much praises this woman for this delicious food. Well, while Early's eating and his men are camping, some of his soldiers are again out trying to find horses, and they're running into these Pennsylvanians that are waving these tickets. Back to Charlie Brown. Charles Brown goes up to one of these Pennsylvania farmers who probably is waving a ticket. Now, Brown himself is a German. So we don't know if he's communicating in German with the locals. A lot of the people in the Big Mount area still spoke German at that point in time. Charles had enrolled back in 1861. Here's his official service record. Absent without leave since June 27, 1863. Straggled on the march from Gettysburg to York and supposed to have been killed by the citizens of Pennsylvania. The local lore here in York County suggests that a farmer near Big Mount had a Confederate try to take his horses. He apparently did wave these tickets. The Confederate ignored it, took the horse, and the farmer killed the Confederate with his gun and buried the Confederate somewhere near Big Mount Road. We don't know where. There are a lot of legends. I've had people show me the perceptive site, but I don't know. Nobody's ever actually went there with a radar detector. It's private property to try to understand whether or not Charlie Brown's really there. So we have the victim. It's Charles Brown. We know all about this guy. His service records confirm the fact that the victim is indeed Charles Brown, 8th Louisiana, and that he was buried here in York County. He's still here. His bones were never dug up. We just have lost the location. But who killed Charlie Brown? Good grief. Who killed Charlie Brown? Well, this is a close-up of the Big Mount area. And you see J.S. Trimmer Store. That is the house that I showed you earlier where Jubal Early is having his dinner. Early's men are camped again somewhere in and around Big Mount. Now the Tigers, as best as we can tell from the order of march that day, the Tigers were probably in the lead. That would have probably put them somewhere either in the area of J. Spar, D. March, Mrs. Hyde, C. Spangler, J. Firestone. So if you see those five names on the top of the screen, one of those people might have been the murderer. Don't know. But let me make a suggestion to you. The farm that you see labeled as J. Spar, remember the name Spar. We're going to come back to that name in another murder mystery later on, where we know in that particular case, on our cold case number four, that the Spar family indeed had a murderer in their midst. And that Spar farm along Big Mount Road heading towards Conowaga Creek is the location that a lot of locals here in York County have suggested that this Confederate was indeed killed on that farm. We don't know that though for sure. And I certainly don't want to impugn the memory of Mr. Spar or anyone else in this region, but it's likely that one of these five farms is where the murder occurred. And Spar's every bit as good a guess as anyone else, and as we'll see later, probably a very good guess as to who the killer was. So that's our first case. We know the killer is. We know roughly where he's buried. He's still there. As far as we know, he's the only gunshot victim in York County who died of an enemy action here in York County as far as the Confederates go. And he's murdered by a civilian. Here in York County. Now, the second story I want to talk about is a totally different twist. in this particular case, we know who the killer is. We know all about the killer. We've never been able to identify the name of the victim. Unlike Charlie Brown, where we don't know who killed him, we think it may have been Mr. Spar. We just don't know. In this particular case of our second story tonight, we don't know much at all about the victim other than the fact he was from New York. That's all we know. So let's talk about this story. As the Confederates are coming into the area again, as mentioned, they are going all over to get horses. In South Central York County is a small village known as Glenville. And just north of Glenville, off Smoketown Road, is a village called Green Ridge. This is maybe 15 miles or so east from northeast slightly from Hanover and directly south of York. So very rural area, extremely rural area, then and now. You can really get lost back some of these back roads in York County. What I've got circled in the middle in yellow is the German Reformed and Lutheran Church. That was a union church where the German Reformed and the Lutherans had allowed each other to use the same building. It was a church made of stone. It was locally known as the Stone Church. And to this day, in fact, this church is still commonly known as Stone Church. Now, here's our killer. His name's George Bear. His house still lives there on Stone Church Road, just about a mile to 2 miles west of the actual church. George Bear is a prominent miller in that area. He owns both a flour mill and a sawmill that he built in 1825. As with many of our people in our story, he too is a German speaker. We don't know how much English he actually speaks, but like so many third generation, fourth generation York Countyans of the period, German was still spoken around the houses, particularly in these backcountry roads. His mill, by the way, still exists. You can see the picture on the bottom right of the screen of Bear's mill. And again, George Bear's house, wonderfully preserved, is still there on the left. Now, George, like so many York Countyans, has been thoroughly frightened as the stories of Confederate raiders have come forth. Remember, this is, you know, late June 1863, and the Confederates are all over western and southern York County, particularly stealing horses. And so the neighborhoods are all up, they're on edge, and nobody really knows when the Confederates might appear at your doorstep and try to take your horses and try to take your cattle and your hogs out of your fields and out of your pig pens and ride off with them. And so the neighborhoods are really pretty much they're on edge. Now, back in those days, because so much of these areas were rural and remote, and they didn't have telephones, they didn't have the internet, of course, their communication method was very common in Lancaster, York, Adams, Cumberland counties, especially among the farmers. You would blow a horn, you know, a cattle horn or some sort of other horn that would make music. That was, and if you tooted a particular number of times, that was a distress signal. And your neighbors would come running to see if somebody was sick. Was there a problem on your property? Was there a fire perhaps or something going on? And people got very used to these warning signals. These horns would sound that things were going on. Well, as the rebels are coming into York County, as I mentioned on June 27th, the same day that the murder occurs that we talked about earlier in Big Mount, Elijah White's 35th Battalion Virginia Cavalry has raided Hanover Junction. They have went all over the Hanover Junction region as far south as towards Glen Rock, and they're moving throughout the countryside, again, primarily taking horses as well as cattle as the lead element of Jill Borley's division. Now, the Union Army is on their way to Pennsylvania, but they're not there. They're still in Virginia on the 27th. Some lead elements have now arrived in Maryland as they're heading towards Pennsylvania. Well, George Meade on June 28th Sunday, June 28th, has been awakened and has been given command of the Union Army. Meade immediately sets out to start communicating with Washington as to his plans, what he wants to do, where he's going to go, what does he anticipate Robert E. Lee doing, et cetera. You know, it's basically that Sunday afternoon is his first full day in command. And on June 29th, on Monday morning, Meade's got his army on the move, heading again towards Pennsylvania. Most of the Union Army by now is in Maryland. They are between Frederick and Union Bridge. That day, on Monday, June 29th, George Meade sits down and he writes a detailed report of what he's going to do. And he details in this plan where each of his individual corps are going to move. He's sending some troops towards Gettysburg, sending some here to York County towards Hanover, and he's sending other folks towards Manchester on their way here to York. And his goal is to have this message telegraphed to Henry Wager Halleck, a major general in the War Department, a commander-in-chief of the Union armies in Washington. He also wants messages sent to Couch in Harrisburg and General Robert Schenck in Baltimore as well. Now, Meade has got the 93rd New York Infantry used as his headquarters guard. He also has the use of the Oneida New York Independent Cavalry that he's using as couriers. He is going to send a courier, one man, all alone, with a pouch containing these orders, his plan of operations that he needs to send to the telegraph station. Now, there are no telegraph stations at Union Bridge, Maryland, or in the Manchester area. The nearest one that's operational that Meade knows about is in Glen Rock, Pennsylvania, in southern York County. So he is going to dispatch a courier to Judson Kilpatrick, his cavalry commander, who was in Littlestown, Pennsylvania, at that point in time. And Kilpatrick's going to tell the courier to go to Glen Rock. Well, this courier, according again to York County lore, reaches the little village of Marburg, now underneath Lake Marburg, was dammed up. The village is actually underwater at Cadore State Park. At the Gallatin house. We know that much. This courier has dinner with Mr. Gallatin very late, 9 p.m. It's pitch black. Now, he can't get to Hanover Junction where the original telegraph line is because those lines are down. And as mentioned, he's going to head towards Glen Rock. Now, as I said earlier, this area is still somewhat rather remote in southern York County. It's a moonlit night, but the moon's not fully out. A lot of these roads are shrouded by canopies of trees. And there's no GPS. He's got no way of knowing where he's going. And a lot of the houses are dark and many of them are set back off the roads. So he can't find his way. He has no clue what's going on. Somehow or another, he stumbles his way to George Bear's house. It's on Stone Church Road. It's right by the road. There may have been lights on, not sure exactly what. But this courier, according to most of the accounts, speaks in English in very loud tones, knocks on the door. He's demanding, somebody come out. He's lost, wants his horse fed, needs water. And again, George Bear's German. We don't know how much English George Bear really knows. We know he knows some. The women inside the house are fearful and they blow that horn to alert the neighbors that there's a problem. And the courier gets upset because they're blowing this horn repeatedly as the warning signal. And the courier tells them, stop that. I'm going to burn your house. I'm going to shoot you. Stop that. Well, George Bear comes to the balcony, assumes this man screaming in English at his women folk must be a Confederate. He pulls out his pistol and he shoots and kills the courier, drops him off his horse right in front of his house in the yard. Now, you see the newspaper coverage. This is the Harrisburg Evening Telegraph talking about it. Again, the women in the house alarm blew the horn. That's the whole story we talked about. And, Bear, when he goes out with a lantern, presumably, discovers that this is a Union soldier, and he's got a dispatch on him. Well, make a long story short, Bear actually ends up surrendering himself. The pouch is taken by another person to the Glen Rock Telegraph Station. Message to Washington is in the official records. You can read it today. So the message gets through. But George Bear turns himself in. He surrenders the Army authorities. They're going to take him under escort by train down to Frederick, Maryland. He is going to be put on trial, but he's acquitted. He's allowed to go home, totally exonerated by military authorities. And he goes home on July 11th. He finally goes home at that point, a very much a chagrined man. Now, the Union courier is buried in the graveyard at Stone Church, but all we know is the Union courier. In 1864, again, according to church records and other local records, the soldier's dad comes from New York, upstate New York is all we know, to exhume the body and take the remains home for reburial. And as mentioned, the dispatches are in the official record. Again, if anybody interested, you can read this exact dispatch this guy gave his life to deliver in the OR on part one, 66 through 67. But who was his courier? Who was he? I don't know. George Bear is so shaken up by this thing. You see in the picture, that's the graveyard of Stone Church, original Stone Church, the new church there that was built after the Civil War's brick, but the original church, of course, was stone. George Bear ends up selling his mill and his farm. He retires and goes off to himself. Well, in 1924, George Bear's granddaughter, Susan Bear, Rohrbach, was trying to find the name of the courier. So in 1924, the family itself was trying to find who did George kill. They couldn't find the guy's name, could not understand anything at all about where it happened to George. Well, I ended up going to Miami University, where I graduated from in 1978. Robert Shank, the commander of the Middle Department of the Union Army, from his office in Baltimore, was the commander of all this region. And Shank, like me, was a graduate of Miami of Ohio. So I went through his personal papers and tried to find the records of the trial, hoping that maybe the name of the soldier was there. And no, they never named the soldier. They'd say the courier, the courier, the courier. I'm like, can't you please at least put the guy's name in there? But nope. So I hit a stone wall myself in searching for the lost body at Stone Church. Tim Smith over in the Adams County Historical Society, Lila Foreman Shaw of the York County Historical Society worked together to try to find this guy's name. They couldn't find it. I couldn't find it either, as the family has never found it. I've been up to New York. I've searched the records of the United Guards. I've searched the records of the 93rd New York Infantry. And again, nobody talks about a courier being killed or lost, anywhere before the Battle of Gettysburg. So this goes down as a cold case in the annals of the Gettysburg campaign. Here's our third case. In this particular case, we don't know the victim's name. We don't know the killers. We don't know much of anything, except it happened at Emmett's Grove Campgrounds. You see the ticket on this picture. Emmett's Grove Campgrounds was a popular post-Civil War Methodist and other religious organization campground off of North George Street, the Harrisburg Turnpike, if you will, before I-83 was built. So let's talk about this case. We have our own unknown soldier grave here in York County. This is it. So this is Union unknown soldier. Notice the key words found here, murdered. Murdered. June 28th, 1863, the exact same day that Jube Worley had arrived in York, the day after the murder occurred in Big Mouth, the day before the murder occurred that we just discussed down in Green Ridge at Glenville. So who was this murdered soldier that makes up York County's Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, which, by the way, the local Sons of the Union veterans of the Civil War maintained this tombstone. So let's talk about the Tomb of the Unknown Murdered Soldier. Abbots Grove's campground was along the railroad. You see the Northern Central Railway, that's Manchester, Pennsylvania. That's, again, a few miles north of York, off the turnpike, North George Street. The campground was founded in 1880 near the railroad tracks. There was actually a railroad stop there, and they would bring worshipers up from Maryland, Baltimore, places like that, or from the southern part of York County, or down from Harrisburg or northern Pennsylvania. John Emig, who founded the town of Emigsville here in York County, sold 14 acres of land, well, his heirs did, he was dead, to the church to found this campgrounds. And originally it was Church of the Brethren that held it up. And they had 40 cottages. It was quite a large place. It was destroyed by fire in 1896. But in the back corner of Emmett's Grove Campgrounds was that headstone that I showed you two slides earlier. This headstone was there on the campgrounds. And nobody knew the story behind it. The unknown Union soldier found here murdered, supposedly belonged to the 76th Regiment Pennsylvania Volunteers. We'll get back to that in a minute. Whoops, going the wrong way. So we know these facts. The body was found while Jubal Early's Confederates were in York County. And according to newspaper accounts, the body was clad in the uniform of a Union soldier, the buttons of which contained the coat of arms of Pennsylvania and his cap, the number 65. Wait a minute. The headstone says 76, but the newspaper accounts say 65. Which regiment was it? Was it any of those regiments? Was this guy even a Union soldier? Was somebody impersonating a Union soldier? Who was this guy? Who killed him? What happened? Going through in detail the records of both the 5th Pennsylvania Cavalry, also known as the 65th Pennsylvania Regiment, or the 76th, which was an infantry regiment, nobody shows up as dying in York County. Nobody shows up as dying on June 28th, the date of the murder. Nothing. And no Confederate records that I can find from Jubal Early talk about his men executing a Union soldier. So who was this guy and how he ended up dead in the middle of John Emig's farm field, which again, eventually would become a campgrounds, and who put the original stone up. So who killed him? Let's talk first about the possible suspects. Probably the most likely scenario is if he's a Union soldier, he's murdered by Extra Billy Smith's Virginians. Extra Billy Smith's Virginia Brigade, formerly Jubal Early's Brigade, had camped along North George Street, not terribly far at all from where this victim's body was found. And so if you assume a Confederate did the killing, Smith's Virginians are very high on the list of possible killers, as is Colonel William Henderson French's 17th Virginia Cavalry. Now, they are a little farther north. They're actually north of Emigsville, but they're going to, on Sunday, June 28th, they've ridden all the way up to Mount Wolf. And eventually, they're going to go to York Haven and burn the railroad bridges there, and they're going to return that afternoon. Did they come upon a lone Union soldier walking along the roads heading towards Manchester, Mount Wolf area? Did they kill him? That's certainly a possibility. Well, what about the third possibility? This guy was killed by the citizens of York County. We already know that they're killing Confederates and they're killing Union couriers. Maybe a civilian panicked because he saw a soldier, maybe a deserter from the U.S. Army hospital in York, or maybe a deserter for the state militia or somebody along those lines. Could this man have been a thief? Did he show up at a farm, John Emig's farm specifically, and try to steal something? And did the farmer blow him to kingdom come? Or, final possibility, was the murder of a fellow Union soldier? Now, we had murders here in York County. The fairgrounds at the start of the Civil War was used as a Union Army camp. There were a large number of quarrels and fights. In at least one or two cases, possibly as high as three, soldiers killed each other. So the other possibility is that two soldiers from the Army hospital or from one of the other Union patrols in the area got in a fight at some point. One of them killed the other one, hit his body in this farm field, and we don't know, except for that headstone. That's very specific that the murder occurred on Sunday, June 28th, 1863, which again would imply the Confederates were probably the people to do it. Now, in 1902, the York newspaper wrote this on May 13th, the remains of the unknown soldier that had been interred years ago at the old Emmett's Grove campgrounds was disinterred yesterday by undertaker W.L. Danuse and interred at Prospect Hill Cemetery. So we've dug the body up. In 1902, we moved it to Prospect Hill Cemetery, which is York's largest cemetery along North George Street. 4 years later, again in May, the newspaper wrote, William A. Cook will personally see to it that the grave of the unknown soldier is attended to and properly decorated. The soldier's body for many years reposed in the woods near the campground, and 3 or 4 years ago was removed to Prospect Hill Cemetery through the instrumentality of Samuel C. Ilgenfritz, now deceased, who was then one of the most active members of the Sedgwick post of the Grand Army of the Republic. As mentioned, to this day, this tomb of the unknown soldier in York County continues to be cared for by the sons of Union veterans of the Civil War. But who was this guy? What were the circumstances? Here it is. That headstone that originally was at Emmett's campground, tucked away in the woods at the far corner of a field, now reposes in Prospect Hill Cemetery, not terribly far from the circle where the dead soldiers in the Union Army Hospital who died of disease or gunshots succumbed to their wounds, including 30 bodies that are still there from the Battle of Gettysburg who died in York of their wounds at the U.S. Army Hospital. The Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, not terribly far from there. Those are our three mysteries where we don't know the victim, we don't know the killer, and in this case, we don't know either. Let's talk about the fourth of our cold cases here in York County. And this one is all kinds of facts are known. But what's really not truly known is the motive. And was justice really served? So let's talk about this. As I mentioned previously tonight, the Confederates are raiding this region very heavily for horses. Another raid that we don't often talk about, Major James Nounan brought the 14th Virginia Cavalry down into York County on June 27th and June 28th from the north. Jube Worley came in from the west, Elijah White came in from the southwest, Jeb Stuart on June 30th, it's going to come up from the south. Well, James Noonan's group, probably about 200 men or so from the 14th Virginia Cavalry, are going to march south down from Shimerstown and Camp Hill area in Cumberland County. They're going to come down through Dillsburg and go as far south as Dover on Route 74 and then turn around and head to Carlisle. And as mentioned, Stuart's men are going to come on June 30th. They're going to go through the same region on July 1st. Between Nounan's raid on June 27th and June 28th, and then Jeb Stuart with 4,000 men on July 1st, they are going to take more than 400 horses from York County farmers. And the farmers don't appreciate this one bit. Its summer harvest is going to be coming on in just a few weeks. People are quite upset about the possibility that, you know, our horses are, we need our horses for the summer harvest. Plow horses, particularly, Conestogas, Morgans, Percherons, you know, big, strong plow horses the Confederates have taken for their artillery or to pull their wagons or to ride on. And so the idea of somebody stealing your horse was a pretty big deal back in the 19th century. As we all know from a lot of Westerns and stuff, they hung horse thieves in a lot of areas. And there were committees in places like Carlisle and Mechanicsburg and York and Hanover and Gettysburg and in Hershey There were committees, well, Hershey wasn't around then, but in that area, of course, there were committees that were actively looking for horse thieves throughout that region throughout the 19th century, and they would turn them into the authorities or lynch them, depending on the case. This is Warrington Township, York County. Every farm you see with a red box around it is a farmer that filed a damage claim with a three-man commission to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania after the Civil War, stating that the Confederates took horses from their property. And you can see they're all over Warrington County. Now, Nounan's raid on the 27th and 28th, and then of course, Jeb Stuart on July 1st, have just devastated this region. It's estimated that about two out of every three farmers that had things taken from them filed damage claims. So if you could mentally insert a third more boxes onto this picture, we wouldn't know where to put them, of course. But you can see that most of the majority of the farmers in Warrington Township were victimized. Now, among the people taking horses, perhaps the most prolific horse thief was a black man, probably enslaved. His name was Jim. That's all we know about him. And again, there are people who report this black man taking their horse, including George Emick and other folks. Well, a couple of days after Nounan's raid is over, concurrent with Jubal Early's, with Jeb Stuart's raid, a citizen spots this black man, Jim, still in the region. And he tells the black guy, you better leave. Now, Jim didn't. And we don't know the backstory. We don't know if Jim had escaped from his captor. Remember, we think he's a slave. We don't know if he was still out looking for horses and was trying to connect with Jubal Early or Jeb Stuart. We just don't know a lot of the backstory. We just know that Jim, for some reason, hung around. With six locals that lived in Warrington Township, one of which is Jeremiah Spar. Remember that Jay Spar that lived near Big Mount? Here is a family member, Jeremiah Spar, Company H, 87th Pennsylvania Infantry. He had been home on leave from the 87th Pennsylvania, still got his musket from the regiment. Two more of his family members, Henry Spar and Lewis Spar, and two of their neighbors, Levi Reaver and Lewis Reeser, as well as the merchant of the local country store in their area, which was owned by William R. Smith. All told, eight members of the Spar family have lost horses, several members of the other families as well. This has just crippled the Spar family. Remember, we think possibly a member of the Spar family had killed a Confederate back near Big Mount, back on June 27th. Here on July 3rd, the locals are out looking for Jim. By now, Pickett's charge is going on. Third day of the Battle of Gettysburg, of course. But the citizens of York County are ticked. They want their horses back. They want revenge. And they hear that this black man who was stealing horses in their region was still there. Now, William R. Smith didn't lose much. He did lose a horse. But for him, his matter was the rebels had totally cleaned out his store. They took everything. They cleaned his store out and then grazed their horses in his 6 acres of grass, tore down all of his fences, and just basically wrecked his property. Here are those properties. Look at how they're all really close to each other on Harmony Grove Road, which is between Wellsville and Dover, off of northwest of Route 74. So you see Jeremiah Spar on the top there. There's the Spars. You see the Reesers and Reaver. There's George Spar, and there's William Smith's store. And again, all six of these guys did file damage claims. They did lose horses to the Confederates. So there's no doubt these guys are ticked. And they hear that George is down near them. If you see the red line, that's the township line. But the one in the bottom right circle fronts Conewago Creek. Well, somewhere around Conowago Creek off Debtors Mill Road, near the intersection with Harmony Grove Road, these six men march south on Harmony Grove Road and they find Jim. 4 p.m. and they kill Jim along Harmony Grove Road, about a mile north of the bridge. Jeremiah Ospar, the soldier from the 87th Pennsylvania, shoots Jim 3 times. And then they're going to take the black man's body, dump in the ditch alongside Harmony Grove Road, cover with brush, and walk home, satisfied they did their job, just north of Debtors Mill Bridge, which you see in the bottom right. Well, the court, two citizens are very upset by this. They find the body. They call the coroner in. The coroner holds an inquest, never charges anybody. They bury Jim's body somewhere in York County. We have no clue where Jim is buried. A Davidsburg doctor kept the skull. Again, we have no clue what happened to the skull of this poor guy. But John Wells, who the community of Wellsville is named for his family, and David Cadwallader, whose relative was a Union Army general in Philadelphia, General Cadwallader, they pushed for an indictment. And finally, in August of 1863, Judge Robert Fisher indeed grants their request. He calls a grand jury, and they're going to put the Spar family up for adoption. John Spar, who is Jeremiah, the killer's dad, puts up a $5,000 bond to allow the six men to go free, put his farm up as collateral. Well, somehow or another, it never goes to trial. Not a true bill, which in the language of that day meant not enough evidence to convict anybody. We're going to let him go. And Jeremiah Spar, having murdered a man on the streets of York County, goes back to the 87th Pennsylvania, resumes his military duties, spends the rest of the war in uniform, gets an honorable discharge for the U.S. Army, comes back to York County to his farm, and you know, for much of the rest of his life, will pass by the place where he killed the black man. We don't know if he necessarily had any feelings about that or not. And here's his great, in 1926, Jeremiah Spar dies. His obituary is in the Harrisburg newspaper, dies at the age of 86, a veteran of the Civil War. Doesn't mention anything about him. You see his gravesite on the right. So was it justified? That's the question. For Spar, the three members of the Spar family, for the merchant William Smith, and for Reeser and Reeser, did these six men commit a murder? Was it racial? Did they kill him because he was black? Or did they kill him because he was a horse thief? Did they kill him out of revenge because their horses were gone and they just wanted somebody had to pay? Or is there yet another more sinister agenda at play? Probably not. I mean, my feelings is that Spar and his friends were just ticked. He had a gun. He's a Union soldier. Killing Confederates wasn't a big deal to him. And certainly this, you know, rebel, if you will, black man, servant of the Confederate Army, in his mind may have been a justified target. So with that, those are four murder mysteries that I wanted to talk about here tonight. The brief presentation that I've given, I'm going to turn it back over now to Ricky, and we can answer any questions if you will, but hopefully these stories have entertained you. All are true as far as we know, and obviously if anybody has any letters, diaries, you know, any kind of additional information will help solve these four murder mysteries of the Gettysburg campaign, I'd love to hear it. Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
Great. Great job. Thanks, Scott. Thank you very much. Okay. Does anybody have any questions for Scott? I know you do,
Steve. You need to unmute.
Anybody questions? Go ahead. Unmute yourself and ask the questions. Well, that's a quiet group here.
It is.
Yeah. Well, Scott, Steve Smith here. I can't resist asking a question about the 87th Pennsylvania, since my great-great-grandfather, Israel Boblitz, fought with that unit.
Okay.
I've I've got your book here on Second Winchester. And
Great. Talk a lot about the 87th and that. Yeah, sure.
Right. That's where he was taken prisoner and wound up on Belle Isle.
Okay.
And then later was transferred, I guess, under a prisoner exchange to Camp Parole near Annapolis.
In Maryland. Yep.
And that's where the trail kind of goes cold, except somebody mentioned, I can't remember where I read this, that a police officer in York tapped him on the shoulder in December of 1863. I guess he probably had his belly full of the war by that point and just decided to go home. And they allowed him to go back and serve again with the 87th as a Teamster, I guess, because by that time he wasn't of any further use as a foot soldier. And he was wounded in the Overland campaign, but got an honorable discharge about 2 months after the war ended. So maybe they were making up for the lost time. Can you tell us any more about the 87th? I understand it was recruited in the York and Adams County area.
Yeah, it was. And the 87th was formed in the fall of 1861. Served much of the their original time in was 62 maybe. Anyway, they served most of their time as bridge guards. 61, and they were up until December of 1862. These guys were primarily in Maryland, guarding the Northern Central Railway. In fact, they spent a fair amount of time along what is today the Jones Falls Expressway, or I-83, they had a camp they called Camp Small, which was at Melville, Maryland, where they spent most of their time. They were reassigned to the 8th Corps and were moved to Robert Milroy's command in Winchester, as you know from my book, and spent much of the winter and early spring of 1863 in and around Winchester. They did some forays to some other places and came back and lost heavily at Carter's Woods. In fact, I just gave a tour of the 87th Pennsylvania site, the first public tour of Carter's Woods, now that at Shenandoah Valley Battlefields Foundation has bought the battlefield. And I did a public tour 4 Saturdays ago, I think it was, first tour of the 87th spot. But as we know, most of the men of the 87th had to walk down to Stanton under guard of the Confederates. They were put on trains sent on the Manassas Gap Railway over to Belle Isle and Richmond. Eventually, they were dispersed. Some of them ended up in Andersonville, in fact, and died in Andersonville, as a fact, down in southern Georgia. 87th, of course, is reconstituted with new men. The regiment itself will fight with quite a lot of valor at as part of the 6th Corps at Monocacy in July of 1864. There's a nice monument to them at Monocacy. And so, yeah, this is it's a regiment that York County should be proud of, and Adams County, should be proud of. A fair number of their men actually came from New Oxford. There's an entire company that was raised in New Oxford in Eastern Adams County. There are 2 books, by the way. I don't know if you have... one book is by Dennis Brandt that was put out a few years ago called From Home Guard to Hometown Heroes, about the 87th. And then, of course, there was a book done back in the 19th century by an historian named George Prohl, which had a lot of the 87th data in it. So we're blessed that this regiment had 2 full regimental histories that I could draw from and tons of pension records.
I never thought I'd say he got lucky by being imprisoned on Belle Isle, but I guess it could have been worse.
Yeah, he didn't go to Andersonville.
I would not be sitting here today if he'd wound up in Andersonville.
Yeah, so that's so true.
Thanks for shedding some additional light on that. Very
no problem.
Fascinating presentation tonight. Very well done.
Thanks. Yeah, I mean, it's just like I said, four short little snippets, but as I said, I think people are fascinated, especially in October, by the whole idea of murder mysteries, and it's kind of the seasonality of the thing. I'm just mystified, though, particularly on the story of the courier, because so many people, including the family, since 1924, have been looking for, you know, well, we're talking about almost 100 years that people have looked for this guy's name. Generations before me have been fascinated by this story, and generations after me, hopefully, who read my books and hear the story, hopefully somebody someday will find it. Maybe the answers to all these stories are out there, and maybe not. Maybe my great grandkids will be talking about the murder mysteries in the year 2100. Who knows?
Thanks so much, Scott.
Good.
Any other questions?
Also, just let you know, Scott, I cannot pronounce it last, but Fernando from Venezuela is here. So
Fernando
back again. So, and I do have his email address. I'm going to put him on the email list. So hopefully we'll be here seeing him more in our meetings. But Fernando, welcome. Glad you can make it, and hope to see you in more of our meetings. Okay. Anybody else have any other questions or comments for Scott before we go?
All right. Just one cheap commercial, if you may, Ricky. A lot of these stories could be found in my book, Civil War Stories from York County. That's available on the internet, or you can call our good friend Jim Schmick up at Civil War and More in Mechanicsburg. Jim has signed copies. And again, the book's called Civil War Stories from York County, Pennsylvania.
Okay, fantastic. Jim, I think you're putting him on the our website too, correct? Yeah, Jim's muted. But I do believe Jim's going to be putting your information, on our website. So you can go to Civil War or More, or you could go to our website and get your books.
Yep.
Yes, on the website and on Facebook.
That'll work.
Okay. So we'll close. And for those who are going to Fredericksburg Saturday, we'll see you then. And if not, get a hold of Norm, and we'll like to see you come aboard. So with that, Scott, thank you again. Great job. Everybody appreciated it. And we'll see you all next month, which will be a combination of both be live and at the VVA. I'll send more information out for that. So with that, good night, everybody. And again, Scott, thank you very much. Great job. We appreciate it. We'll hear from you next year, too, I'm sure.
Sounds good. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Thanks.
Night, bye. All. Bye.